So I wanted to know ki, what is the rate of diabetes in women's, I mean, the stage when they are pregnant and all that stuff, polycystic ovaries are there, what are genetic diabetes?
Okay. You said both your parents, father and mother, both are diabetic.
Yeah.
So for sure you stand into a very high risk category. You said that being a female, that as on date the data shows that there's no difference between females and males' prevalence of diabetes. So you stand in equal chance of any other sibling of yours. It's not a sex-linked transmission from parents to children. So, but because both the parents are diabetic, you have a very high chance of getting diabetes. We've already talked about what precautions, what lifestyle modifications, what diet modifications you have to make so as to do primary prevention, delay the onset of from a pre-diabetic or a high-risk category to diabetes. Now, being a female, the additional information which every woman needs to have is that there are one term which you must know is called gestational diabetes.
Yes.
Gestational diabetes is different from normal diabetes. If a woman, a diabetic woman, becomes pregnant, and she will obviously be a diabetic, that is not gestational diabetes.
Okay.
That is a diabetes woman who is pregnant. But if diabetes developed during pregnancy, is called gestational diabetes. The repercussions are that diabetes needs to be treated in a slightly different manner when you are in first trimester of pregnancy, second trimester of pregnancy, and when at the time of the delivery. That the doctors have to be taking care of. There's certain drugs which are not to be used in pregnancy, so the treatment modifies.
Okay. So it's all on the drugs that
yeah, and not only drugs, and the second is slightly the control, tighter control, because the effects on the fetus are there. So if you do not have tight control, otherwise in your life you may have little liberty, but during pregnancy it is said that the controls have to be little tighter.
Okay. My mother and mother actually has now gone into dialysis stage. My father being very cautious about it, but it happened that now she is on dialysis. And it's very high stage and she's all dependent on dialysis. Her life at present date, it's all because of the diabetes that she's standing also, dialysis that she's standing also. How to lead such a life, I mean?
What is the reason that she's developed this, we call it end stage renal disease. What is the reason that she's gone into this? Is it the diabetic nephropathy?
Okay.
Or kidney failure because of any, most likely it would be diabetic nephropathy. Long-standing diabetes, she's gone to kidney disease, kidney affection, that's called nephropathy, and gradually it leads to end-stage renal disease. Once the patient is in end-stage renal disease, there's no option but renal replacement therapy. Either you're on dialysis, you're doing chemical replacement, or you need to replace the kidney. There are no other options.
But replacing his kidney is advisable?
100%.
100%.
If other biological parameters permit.
Okay.
Parameters.
There should be no other complications other than diabetes.
There are certain complications which can be taken care of. There are certain do's and don'ts if the patient's hemoglobin, if his blood drop, if his other comorbidities, diabetic control, blood pressure control, cholesterol, those all need to be considered deciding whether this patient is fit to have a renal replacement or not.
Okay.
That a nephrologist, a nephrosurgeon will be able to decide whether the patient is in a suitable candidate for kidney transplant or not.
Okay. That all depends on the condition of the patient.
Condition of the patient.
Whether the patient is apt for
more important than that is the only option available to you when patient is already in end stage renal disease is dialysis or renal replacement.
So one thing she has not mentioned is that her father is a very leading expert as an interventionist cardiologist in Jaipur. In fact, he was the first interventionist cardiologist of Jaipur, and he set up the cardiology department in that Santhoba Durlabji Hospital. So he has been monitoring the problem of the mother and monitoring her doses and seeing that she takes. It's been a very tight control because she's been married now into our family for last about 13 years. So that tight control I have seen over the years. And then one day I was discussing with him, so how long can you be on dialysis? Because her mother has been on dialysis now for exactly 3 years. November of 2013 is when she started. So he said that it's roughly about 3 years is the time that you can go on dialysis. Of course, there have been cases where you've gone on longer. But on an average, they say about 3 years is you can manage a patient on dialysis. So would you like to throw any light on that? Or in spite of huge control monitoring, and she is about my age, 65, 66. It's not that she's very old or into her 70s or something.
This makes me answer one very important aspect of diabetes management. This is a question which comes up many times that I'm a diabetic, good control all my life. Why do I get nephropathy? Why do I get retinopathy? Why did I get a heart attack? You see, despite all measures, despite diet control and other measures, there are certain complications which are bound to come to a diabetic. Nephropathy is one of them. And the other aspect which needs to be highlighted here is there is a kind of a legacy effect. In earlier part of your diabetic life, when you became diabetic, say 35 or 40 years, first 5 years, what was your control? In our country, the trend is that the worst control is seen in that time. Everyone says, no, it is a little high, I'm not worried. They only rush to a doctor when it is already 400, 300. That's when they're 55, 60. And then they are very tight controlled. The purpose has already been defeated.
Mm-hmm.
The process, the triggering of getting into those complications has already started. I always insist that once diabetes is picked up, that's the time when you need to take care of. Have a tight control for first 5, 7, 10 years. Later on, maybe a little relaxed. If an 80-year-old person comes to me with 200 sugar, what is going to happen? Nothing. Probably heart attack after 15 years, doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
But a 50, 45-year-old person says, "Kine 300 chalti hai, I want to avoid doctor, give me another 6 months, I will do exercise, I will do my diet control," but not able to do it, sugar continues to be 200, he is bound to get diabetic, retinopathy, nephropathy,
mm-hmm.
and cardiac complications.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe in earlier part of the diabetic life, whether it went undiagnosed for first 5 years, you never know, you never been to a doctor, you never got any surgery done, so blood sugar was never done, you had no symptoms. So that is the time when you already set the tissues to develop those complications.
Okay.
And secondly, I said the certain complications, some microvascular complications, some macrovascular complications are bound with longevity of diabetes. It's duration dependent, not diet control dependent.
Sir, how are varicovins connected or related or can be related with this situation?
With diabetes?
Yeah. And why do varicovins occur?
Not in this context of diabetes. Varicoveins, when you have the venous structure of your walls returned, veins have a one-way wall. The blood can only flow from up to down to upwards, only towards your heart. The blood is returned through the veins. It's arteries supply the blood and then veins return the blood. And veins have a one-way wall. If you can see it, you do like this and then do like this. You can see the blood can only flow in one direction. If those walls are weak, there's a tendency for pooling of blood into your veins. The blood tends to collect there and doesn't come up. There are medical reasons for developing varicose veins. I'm just telling you what happens in varicose veins, and that's called varicose veins. Its connection with diabetes, I think only the microvascular complications, because the blood supply to the smaller vessels is affected in diabetes, that could be a little associated factor. Otherwise, per se, diabetes and varicose veins have
no
relation.
And how are I had a like I being a daughter of a diabetic family, so I'm also obese to a little extent. What I had a gallbladder problem also about 4 years, 5 years back. So it was like it was so extreme that I had to get my gallbladder removed, and after that the issue came was polycystic ovaries.
It is not that issue came up later. When we're talking about what causes diabetes, I talked of one term called insulin resistance. And the associates of insulin resistance, who is going to have insulin resistance? One of the associates is a polycystic ovarian disease. One is that you must have seen a lot of people who have black spot cell. That's another associate. These are the clinical markers which indicate that the person is likely to have insulin resistance. But genetically, obese, central obesity, polycystic disease in women, that's one associate which is normally seen together. A woman has polycystic ovary disease, obviously she's got, you have family history of diabetes, so you have insulin resistance in you, 100% for sure. That is why you have PCOD also. So that's an associate of, so they are the people who are, one of my slides will show that who are the people who need to screen themselves. People who have high risk category, and under the high risk category, all the women who have PCOD. Because we know PCOD associates always exist together with insulin resistance. Gallbladder disease, gallbladder stones are cholesterol stones, you know. It's, and if you have your diet or your physical exercise is like that, that you're developing, you're depositing fat in you, you said you're obese. So that has led to gallbladder disease as well, and that will contribute to insulin resistance as well. It's not that diabetes is called gallbladder stones.
So there was one question I want to ask regarding her. What happened was she was pregnant with her first grandchild. And she had a very, very normal pregnancy in the sense that for the first 3 months, we did not realize that there is a fetus in her body. In the sense that from when we go back into the history, the first 2 or 3 weeks when the fetus was there, she was doing all kinds of dances for the Teej festival that was there. Then about beginning of October, she was doing these yoga exercises, including that stomach pumping that Baba Ramdev, one of the things, and all the asanas and everything. And then she just went with my wife to Moolchand Hospital. So there is a medical, Ayurvedic medical doctor called Dr. Manjubala who's there. And she just saw her and she said to my wife, Nalini, I think Khushbu is pregnant. So she said, how are you doing? She said, no, test karo immediately. So she went, since she was in Moolchand Hospital, she bought that rabbit test medicine and it came. Ye nahi dobara karo, wo ho gaya. Usme bhi confirm aa gaya. And then we did an ultrasound, so it was confirmed. So by that time, it was about 3 months that she was carrying a baby. And we didn't know. She had a very normal delivery, in the sense it was her first delivery. When her 9th month started, she was playing badminton. So in fact, I got angry with her because we were at her sister's farm. I said, what is this? You're playing badminton. It was not even a level ground. So we got into major complications. Unfortunately, we lost that kid. Within 48 hours of the birth, he had a, what do you call the crib death. We could not identify. There were some blotches on his body. And exactly 48 hours to his being born, he died. So she went into a state of shock. Why I'm saying all this is that when we applied, and this is 2 months later, we had to do the gallbladder surgery. So when I applied under the Mediclaim insurance thing, they said it's a pre-existing disease.
Which pre-existing?
The gallbladder operation as such. So I said that how can it be pre-existing? Ultimately from October to the time that she delivered in April, she's been going through huge amount of tests. It could be ultrasound, it could be x-rays, it could be the other tests that were going on, and there was nothing that was there. She developed it as a shock or something towards the end of April. So in fact she had a pancreatic attack, and I think thanks to her father, who did not take her to the ICU of Santokh Bahadur Durlabji Hospital, he took 2 private rooms and monitored that entire care for that pancreatic problem in that ICU, creating that ICU and putting his nurses from his cardiology department to look after her and monitor her, that we were able to get her out of that pancreatic shock. But then he told me that you please shift her from Jaipur, because she's from Jaipur, to Delhi. So within about 10 days or suddenly she's developed huge amount of stomach issues. So we rushed her in the night to Gangaram Hospital. They said, nothing, not to worry. Please don't bother about it. Then after 4 or 5 days, again she was rushed in the night. So then they said, we must do an entire checkup and everything. And that's when we declared that these gallbladder stones were there. So then we contacted Dr. Chaube and he did the operation. So this is what I would like to throw. Is there any correlation between this, ultimately because it's on the gastrointestinal tract, is there any kind of correlation? Is there coming out of shock or something?
I think there are several issues which have been raised. Let's try to address one by one. One, you said that losing a baby, that's very difficult to comment on what was the reason. And during a 9 months of pregnancy, what investigations showed, I do not know. Was there any high risk category? Was there any problem during those 9 months?
No, sir.
Nothing. Let me tell you, most of the...
She did not have gestational diabetes or anything. In the second delivery, yes, she had.
Okay. Now, second thing, you said gallbladder disease. Most of the ultrasound done during pregnancy must have been obstetric ultrasound.
Okay.
In which lower abdomen was screened, never an upper abdomen.
Mm-hmm.
So, gallbladder was never seen.
Okay.
She may be having a gallbladder disease. Very unlikely that when she developed pain and you got and you found that no gallbladder stone has developed. Not possible.
Okay.
Very likely she had gallbladder stone for quite some time. Likely. But all the ultrasound were done for the pelvis, not for the whole abdomen.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the reason which I can think of.
Okay.
And that is why the insurance people said the gallbladder disease was existing, pre-existing. And there is no relation that such amount of stress, losing a baby, and within 5 days of very acute stress can lead to gallbladder stone formation.
Mm-hmm.
Of, they can give rise to 10 other problems, but gallbladder stone is a slow, insidious process development of a stone in a gallbladder. It's a deposition of cholesterol there.
So and in fact, Dr. Chaube, when he saw all the reports, he says you're predisposed to gallbladder stones because...
That's predisposition, yes.
Because he said you are white. You're obese?
5F. Female, fertile, rare, flatulent,
yeah.
Fat.
So we laughed in the hospital when he said this.
That's a very
No, we are not heard of it because we are not
has
a medical word.
Has a fair, fat, but flatulent and fertile.
Hmm.
So that's the thing which we were doing in who will develop stone. Yeah. So stone development is, I don't see any correlation
between
pregnancy period or the stress period. Of
and what about the pancreatic attack?
Pancreatitis is normally, the etiology of pancreatitis still rock question mark. Why does the patient get into pancreatitis?
Previously, they say it's fatal, most of the time it is fatal.
It can be fatal. It is a very acute pancreatitis.
It's a very dangerous scenario.
With time, the cause of pancreatitis is daily changing. I mean, when we were in medical school, the only reason for pancreatitis was alcoholism.
Mm-hmm.
Later on, we realized that we have a pancreatitis which develops without alcohol is not the cause. So, a lot of different hypotheses why does one get pancreatitis.
But because of that pancreatic attack, is it likely that the insulin production would have gone down or something? And because this was 2005. It's 11 years past, 11 and a half
how
years.
How much pancreas destruction took place?
So can that be monitored?
That can be monitored by a CT scan.
By a particular test?
CT scan.
Okay.
Contrast in our CT scan of the abdomen, they show whether there's any destruction of the pancreas, loss of the head of the pancreas, which beta cells are there.
Okay.
So that could be the one.
How is intake of tobacco related with diabetes? Like it is bad for diabetes or?
Yes, it is bad for diabetes because all stimulants for that matter, be it caffeine, tobacco or tea and coffee, all are bad for because they tend to change your metabolism and sugar levels tend to go high.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
all
a diabetic person
yes, that's very clear. They should abstain from tobacco and smoking altogether, alcohol in moderation. All other stimulants, totally no. Alcohol, of course, a lot of jugglery about alcohol and diabetes. Red wine is supposed to be good for you.
Yeah.
But there are a lot of issues with alcohol as well. Okay. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.